unforgiven because you were forsaken. I'm accepted, you were condemned, and I'm alive and well. Your spirit is within me because you died and rose again. I'm forgiven because you were forsaken. I'm accepted, you were condemned. I'm alive and well, your spirit is within me because you died and rose again.
Good morning, and welcome to Prayer and Devotion on this Monday, July 13th. We are actually coming to the close. We only have two more days of the devotion that we've been walking through. It is good to be with you today. My name is Cindy Stauffer. I'm the pastor at the United Methodist Church at New Brunswick, and every day we gather here for time of scripture, studying God's word, letting it sink into our hearts and our minds as we begin the day. And so it is good to be with you all today. Good morning, Daniel. Good morning, Kemi and Vinette. Good morning, Cyril and Cheryl. Good morning, Celia and Vinette and Priscilla and Renetta and Siege. Good morning, Andrea and Minda and Betty and Priscilla. I'm glad to have you here this morning. So if you've got your Bibles, today we're looking at a verse where we've been walking through Psalm 27, and today we are looking at verse 12. So if you wanna open up your Bibles, Psalm 27, 12. And we're just looking at the first, we're doing the whole thing. So Psalm 27, 12 says, "Do not give me up to the will of my adversaries, for false witnesses have risen against me, and they are breathing out violence." Do not give me up to the will of my adversaries, for false witnesses have risen against me, and they are breathing out violence. Our devotion from a shelter in the time of storm is entitled today, False Witnesses. And this is what it says. It really does hurt when you are falsely accused. It's painful to think that someone is convinced that you did something that you didn't do. It is frustrating to be accused of a wrong you had nothing to do with. It is maddening when you seem unable to do anything to explain or defend yourself. All of us have experienced it. We play the accusation over and over in the DVD player in our brain. We rewind the accusatory conversation. We wonder what people think about us, haunted by the soiled reputation we are convinced that we will now carry around. We look for ways to justify ourselves. We search for things we can say or do to restore our reputation. It is painful to be innocent, yet unable to live with the charges that have been made against us. Your Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ, was in that place. But he put himself there on purpose. Confused? Let me explain. Jesus came to earth knowing exactly what he was going to be facing. He came as an act of submission to the Father's great redemptive plan. He came with a willing spirit, willing to face the very things that we all work to avoid and find so painful when they are unavoidable. Passages like Isaiah 53 and these verses from Psalm 27 give us a window into the depth of the love of Christ. It is almost impossible to conceive that the King of Kings, the great Creator, the sovereign Son of God, would submit to this. He would submit to being betrayed by a close friend. He would submit to being led away toward a wrongful trial. He would submit to being forsaken by his closest followers. He would submit to false accusations. He would submit to gross injustice. He would stand silent while being mocked. He would submit to slaps on the face. He would not defend himself against physical torture. He would submit to a mob that would call for his death. He would submit to the pain of a crown of thorns. He would be willing to drag his cross to the place of his execution. He would submit to being identified with criminals. He would submit to nails being driven into his limbs. He would be willing to have his father turn his back on him. Yes, he knew the cruelties and injustices that he would face, and he was willing. In that final moment before he faced the unthinkable, Jesus prayed something very, very similar to Psalm 27:12. He prayed, "Father, if it be possible, let this cup pass from me." In other words, do not turn me over to the desire of my foes. But then he added these words of amazing submission, words that made our salvation possible. "Not as I will, but as you will." Jesus knew the plan. From the first moment of his life on earth, he knew that he was marching toward that moment when he would be turned over to the desire of his foes. He knew false witnesses would seal his death. He knew, but they did not. They didn't know they weren't in charge. They didn't know that they were part of a greater plan. They had no idea that long before they were born, God had chosen to turn their moment of deceit and injustice into a moment of triumph and salvation. He knew false witnesses were in his future. He is the Savior, and he was willing. I don't know that we always think through all of that. I think often we'll take that walk during Holy Week, but do we do that the rest of the year? Do we take time to really think about all that Jesus endured for you and for me? It almost seems, I mean, we know that there have been people that have been tortured in this world, but the way that Jesus endured all of that, with this perfect submission, seems so beyond what you and I are capable of doing. In the face of false witnesses, trusting and submitting to God's plan is really hard. I think we work so hard to justify ourselves. Sometimes when we're actually rightly accused, we will go in that direction. But to be falsely accused and to submit. One of the questions that they ask at the end today is, I encourage you to read Hebrews 4 through 5 and thank Jesus that he was willing to suffer that you and I would, what you and I suffer, so that we that he would be able to offer grace that is appropriate to our time of need. The offering of grace, a free gift. For you and I, we do not deserve what Jesus did for us. But Jesus did that anyway. And so when we think about our own lives and the things that you and I endure, because we do, we walk through really challenging things. And how many times do we think in our mind, nobody understands, nobody knows the troubles I've seen, but Jesus. But nobody knows the pain that I'm walking through right now. Nobody knows, and it is so easy to feel frustrated and look and think, you know, I'm all alone in this. I've got nobody that understands me or feels all of the struggles that I'm going through. But the good news for you and I, friends, is that not only do we have a God who loves us, but we have a God that was willing to come down. That's big. Like, it's really big. I know we often focus on the cross, which is what we're talking about today, but we have to start with the incarnation. We have a God that wanted to know what we know. That is our Creator. Our Creator wanted to feel what we feel, to endure what we do endure, to experience not just the trials, but the joys, to fully feel what you and I feel. This is not a distant God. This is a God that loves his creation more than you and I can even begin to imagine. And that our God would endure all of the agony that I listed before for you and I, that we would know that when we are faced, when we are walking through times of being falsely accused, when we have been rejected, when we have been betrayed, when we are enduring pain at the hands of another, that we're not alone, that we, our God, has taken that walk and moved into a place beyond all of that. And so that is our hope that we hold firmly to. And it begins here in Psalm 27. Do not give me up to the will of my adversaries. Do not give me up to the will of my adversaries. And then the beginning of verse 13 is, I believe that I shall see the goodness of the Lord. I almost wonder if that was in the head, in Jesus's head as he hung there from the cross. I believe that I shall see the goodness of the Lord in the land of the living, that he could offer forgiveness to those, all those that stood and purposely, falsely accused and caused him so much pain. Are we able to do that? I think it's so challenging. But we do have a model for it. And so today, I encourage you, if you are facing trials, to be reminded again that you and I have a Savior that has offered us grace when we didn't deserve it. What would it mean for us to do the same? Let us pray. God, we come to you this morning in need of your grace. Lord, we come to you this morning in need of your forgiveness, in need of your mercy. Lord, we come to you this morning in need of your steadfast love. We acknowledge that too often, when things get tough, we want to lash back. When people accuse us, we want to defend ourselves. When people turn away from us, it breaks our heart. But in you, Lord, we have one who not only will never turn away or abandon, but we have a God who knows us so intimately, knows what it is that we endure daily, and came that we might know the depth of his love for us. We thank you, Lord. We thank you that you love us this much. We thank you for all that you did, for your willingness to submit even when the path ahead seems so grim. Lord, we thank you and we love you. We honor and we praise you because we know that there are days where it is just too difficult to imagine living this out. And yet you stand there in the face of mockers, in the face of rejection and denial, and you look on us with love. Forgive us, Lord, for the times that we have been the ones that have falsely accused you. Forgive us for the times that we have betrayed you and denied you and slandered you. Forgive us, Lord, for we are in need of your grace. Thank you, Lord. Thank you. Let us together pray the prayer that Jesus taught his disciples. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who have trespassed against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen. Well, I pray that you have a wonderful day. It looks beautiful out there. If you're heading out to work, may you be filled with God's grace and love. May it carry you through all of your interactions this day. And may you be reminded again and again, friends, that God loves you. And so do I. I'll see you tomorrow.